WorldLink TV presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
From Abu Dhabi TV, welcome to the news in brief. Jordan states that it will host a summit between U.S. President George Bush and the prime ministers of Palestine and Israel in Aqaba, along with the Jordanian monarch Abdullah II. The presidents of China and Russia call for reestablishing stability in Iraq and relieving the humanitarian situation there. Two soldiers were killed and nine others injured by missile and light arm attacks in the city of Fallujah, west of Baghdad. Two immigrants were killed by U.S. fire and six others were arrested. The Euromed Forum at the island of Crete in Greece concludes its work, reiterating the importance of the roadmap for peace, stating that it must include peace with Syria and Lebanon. Israeli occupation forces continue air raids on the city of Jenin and three nearby villages after its reoccupation. A Palestinian woman was martyred by occupation forces in the refugee camp of Tul Karam. 24 people from the same family were killed by a group of armed men in the area of Shlif, west of the capital of Algeria. India pledges to improve its relationship with Pakistan, and Islamabad appoints Aziz Ahmed Khan, Pakistan's foreign ministry spokesman, as ambassador to India. This is the end of the news in brief.
The Palestinian Prime Minister, Mahmoud Abbas Abu Mazen, has to make a difficult choice on how to deal with the Islamic and National Palestinian Resistance organizations. He can either use the language of dialogue or the language of power. The Palestinian Resistance organizations refuse to stop resistance operations as long as Palestinian lands are under occupation. The Palestinian Prime Minister is faced with several challenges. The most important one was created by the approval of the roadmap by the Israeli government, which means that the Palestinian government is now obligated to fulfill the Israeli security demands, or what Tel Aviv calls fighting terrorism.
الفهم الفلسطيني للمغزى الإسرائيلي من الإصرار على محاربة ما يسمى بالإرهاب.
Israel constantly demands the Palestinian Authority to fight what Tel Aviv calls Palestinian terrorism. This pushed the Palestinian Prime Minister Mahmoud Abbas, Abu Mazen, and different Palestinian organizations to vow not to fall into a civil war.
ومن هنا جاءت مسارعة أبو مازن.
To achieve that objective and explain his position, Abu Mazen went to Gaza to meet with the leaders of different Palestinian groups who are leading the armed struggle against Israel. Leaders from Hamas and Jihad organizations say that Abu Mazen did not demand that they stop the armed operations against Israel and confirm that they will continue these operations as long as Israel continues killing and victimizing the Palestinians.
The Palestinian government has difficult demands to meet, but I refuse to call it a security government. This government is the government of law, and it is in charge of fulfilling the rights of the Palestinian citizens. This is the primary job of the Palestinian government, not to fulfill the Israeli security demands.
Israel wants Abu Mazen to use power when dealing with the Palestinian organizations, or what it considers terrorist organizations, but Abu Mazen wants to avoid that. Nonetheless, Abu Mazen is facing a difficult test because he repeatedly emphasized the importance of giving up the armed operations in exchange for dialogue and negotiations. He advocated the use of negotiations in order to achieve peace and establish an independent Palestinian state with Jerusalem as its capital. Now Abu Mazen has to be very careful because he is obligated to fulfill the demands of the first stage of the roadmap. He is required to provide Israel with security, end the armed operations, collect the arms from the Palestinians, and imprison those that are involved in armed operations.
باعتقال الواقفين خلفها وبجمع الأسلحة.
هدف خارطة الطريق هو
Its objectives are to stop the Palestinian resistance and make it possible for the Israeli occupation to achieve its objectives.
من أجل مصلحة الإسرائيليين.
Building more and more settlements and changing more and more the situation on ground for the sake of Israelis.
فصائل المقاومة الفلسطينية
The Palestinian resistance organizations informed Abu Mazen that they refused to stop resisting the Israeli army and settlers and that their ceasefire would not change Sharon's position toward the Palestinians.
بلغة التهديدات المبطنة منها أو العلنية
The organization said that Abu Mazen did not threaten them directly or indirectly. After Sharon's government has approved the roadmap, Abu Mazen's new government faces its first test. How will the first Palestinian prime minister fulfill the first stage of the American plan, which demands him to stop the operations against Israeli targets? Will he use the language of dialogue, or will he use the language of power? El Madar Program, Abu Dhabi Television, Jerusalem.
Before the war in Iraq, Egypt was one of the countries in the region that was worried about the implications of occupying Iraq. Cairo feared that its regional role would be negatively affected as a result of the direct American military presence in Iraq. It feared that Washington would no longer need its strategic Arab allies in the region. What are the concerns of Egypt? Will it still be a major friend to the U.S., and will it continue to be one of the biggest recipients of U.S. foreign aid? Our reporter in Cairo provided us with the following report. Egypt has played a major role in the Islamic, Arabic, and African worlds throughout history. However, its regional role has changed throughout history in response to the local and international changes. During the last 50 years, Egypt has strengthened its regional role. After Gamal Abdel Nasser took over the presidency in the 1950s and 1960s. However, in 1967, the role of Egypt was weakened by the Arab defeat in the 1967 war. And again, after Egypt signed a peace agreement with Israel, which prompted most of the Arab countries to cut their ties with Egypt. The American Secretary of State at the time, Henry Kissinger, predicted that. However, in the 1980s, the role of Egypt in the region was changed. Arab countries re-established their relations with Egypt, and the Arab League headquarters was returned to Cairo. However, Egypt was now constrained with its peace treaty with Israel and its good relationship with the U.S. The United States used its relationship with Egypt in different ways. At one point, it used Cairo to organize the group of Arab countries in a Western alliance to expel the Iraqi forces out of Kuwait in 1991. Egypt was also used to make peace between Israel and other Arab countries. Today, the intensified American military presence in Iraq casts doubts about the U.S. need for Egypt to play its traditional regional role.
Only Israel has a true and effective regional role. Egypt can no longer play that kind of role. The Egyptian role vis-a-vis the United States has shrunk. The only way to deal with this new reality is to create a true democracy and improve the Egyptian government's relationship with its own people. That also applies to the rest of the Arab regimes. They should understand that they cannot improve their countries unless they change themselves.
However, other analysts have different opinions, and Egypt has the ability to oppose the American military presence in Iraq.
It is inaccurate to say that the Egyptian regional role is diminished. The United States still needs Egypt to play a regional role for political reasons.
تتعلق بين مصر ومقر الجامعة العربية.
The headquarters of the Arab League are in Egypt, which has the ability to pass resolutions by influencing the way Arab countries vote.
في هذه الحدود الأمر مقبول.
The Egyptian role is still important, and thus the United States will never allow its relationship with Egypt to deteriorate.
درجة حافة المواجهة أو خسارة مصر.
على النظام السياسي في مصر إذا أن يقبل بأحد.
The Egyptian government has to choose one of two difficult choices.
الثورة المصرية في خدمة الأهداف القومية العربية.
It can devote itself to the service of national Arab goals, and will be willing to pay the price for that, or it can devote itself to the service of American interests, which is not going to be easy.
حتى ولو كانت صعبة.
Tariq Al-Shami, Al-Madar Program, Cairo.
سنة أبو ظبي، القاهرة.
The U.S. Central Command admitted that three U.S. soldiers were killed in a flare-up of attacks in Iraq that continued for a second day on Tuesday. 11 soldiers were also wounded in the three attacks. The latest occurred in the flashpoint town of Fallujah, where Iraqi fighters opened fire on U.S. troops, killing one and injuring seven others.
The spate of attacks against U.S. occupation forces in the past 2 days in Iraq underscores the tenuousness of the U.S. hold on the country. The U.S. admitted that three soldiers were killed and 11 others were wounded in attacks since Monday. In the latest attacks, early Tuesday, one U.S. soldier was killed and seven others injured by rocket-propelled grenades and small arms in the Iraqi southern town of Fallujah that also left two of the attackers dead, according to the U.S. Central Command. In the attack, a U.S. Army medical evacuation helicopter was hit when a U.S. Bradley fighting vehicle struck it while maneuvering into a firing position. CENTCOM said that on Monday alone, four of its soldiers died and six others were wounded in various armed attacks and what it called accidents. One U.S. soldier was killed and three injured when their vehicle ran over a landmine or some other unexploded ordnance on a highway leading to Baghdad Airport. The circumstances were unclear, but witnesses said Monday that a burst of gunfire preceded the explosion. Earlier, the U.S. military reported the death of one soldier and the wounding of another in a convoy that was ambushed by unidentified Iraqis near the Haditha town northwest of the Iraqi capital. CENTCOM said that things got worse when it claimed that one of its soldiers drowned after diving into water channel south of the northern city of Kirkuk. The command added that another soldier was killed and two more injured, claiming that their vehicle collided with a tractor trailer on a road northwest of the city of Talil. On the other hand, the Supreme Assembly for the Islamic Revolution in Iraq stepped up its campaign against the U.S.-led administration's decision to dissolve its military wing.
I think that Iraqis should be given a chance to stand up for themselves from the armed and organized remnants of the former regime that still has its leaders. This is a wrong decision because there was no coordination with the Iraqi political powers that must take part in achieving peace and security in the country. The idea of handing over weapons is a good one, but when there is a ruling regime, however, when there is no government and no one capable of keeping security and stabilization, it's natural that the people should be given the right to defend themselves.
The Assembly's number two, Sayyid Abdulaziz Al-Hakim, said that the Badr Brigade had given more than 2,500 martyrs in the struggle against the Saddam Hussein regime, adding that the decision to dissolve it goes against the agreement among opposition groups to incorporate the armed forces in the new Iraqi army to be formed soon. The decree effectively dissolves all militias except those of the Kurdish factions in northern Iraq, which were exempted as coalition members.
UN nuclear inspectors say they will return to Iraq by the end of this week to check on radioactive material at the country's largest nuclear facility. IAEA spokesman Mark Gwazdecki said the inspectors will head to the sprawling Tuwaitha nuclear complex and investigate whether nuclear material stored there under International Atomic Energy Agency seal since 1991 remains safe and accounted for.
I can report today that we've reached agreement with the government of the United States to dispatch a mission of our experts to Iraq pursuant to Iraq's obligations under the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. Our mission will be leaving for Iraq towards the end of this week. Their job will be to visit the nuclear storage facility near Al-Tuwaitha. and Iraq's main nuclear research complex to determine what nuclear material might have gone missing as a result of the looting and reports of looting and destruction that we've seen over the last 6 weeks, to try to collect as much of this material as possible, repackage it, reseal it, secure the facility. And as I say, that's pursuant to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. It's distinct from the question of weapons inspections, whether or not the United Nations weapons inspectors have a role in the future in Iraq is a subject for the Security Council, and they decided last week that they would be considering this matter in the future. So as far as UN weapons inspectors are concerned, we will await the guidance of the Security Council. The mission that we are mounting for this particular week is pursuant to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty and to a specific nuclear storage facility near El Tuwaitha.
Now we present you with a videotape of an execution that took place in Iraq. According to Reuters, the tape could have been filmed in March of 1985. The tape shows several officers from the Iraqi military intelligence executing three men that were accused of cooperating with Iran during the Iraq-Iran war. The Iraqi intelligence used explosives to kill the men. The explosives were detonated from a distance after somebody sentenced them to death somewhere in the desert. We would like to warn the audience about the graphic nature of these images.
The following men went out of their way and collaborated with the Persian regime. The criminal Ali Abdullah Shawqi. The criminal Jum'a Muhammad Aziz. The criminal Mahdi Saleh Ali.
This is how you are going to kill me.
We welcome Nabil Khoury, the U.S. State Department spokesman. The Iraqis say that the American government is the one that rid them of Saddam Hussein's regime, but they also say that they do not want the U.S. to dominate Iraq. Some Western countries like France and Russia also say that the U.S. is dominating Iraq. How can the U.S. translate its military victory in Iraq into political victory?
The United States will be successful by respecting all parties in Iraq and the Iraqi will. The United States will help the Iraqis to reach an agreement on how to govern their country, so they won't need the Americans. The United States played a major role in ending the former Iraqi regime. Currently, Iraq is going through a difficult period. It suffers from chaos and lack of security because it's in a transition period. For the first time in history, the Iraqis are experiencing freedom and they need to make choices. Since the independence of Iraq, the Iraqis never needed to talk among themselves about how they could reach an agreement to build a new government. That is not an easy task. The Iraqi people have the capability to do so, but they lack the experience. The United States' interest can be secured if a moderate, federal, democratic government can be established in Iraq. The sooner the United States can achieve that, the better it is. If the United States can achieve that in a few months, that would be very good. It would be better for the United States if the Iraqis no longer needed the United States.
What if democracy in Iraq brings about a government that is not desirable to the United States?
We have a great opportunity in Iraq to create a democracy because the Iraqi people are very diverse. In other countries in the region, one group tends to dominate over other groups because they do not have a diverse population. In Iraq, we have pluralism in ethnic groups and political parties. Thus, it would be difficult for one group to dominate over other groups. Some say that the Shiites form a majority in Iraq. That may be right, but the Shiites have more than one political party, and they should have more than one political party. It is better for them to have pluralism because that creates balance. This way, the interests of the minority groups can be protected. I am confident that the Iraqis will reach an agreement. The democracy that will be established in Iraq will not threaten the United States' interests or destabilize the region. I do not think that one extreme group can dominate over the other groups.
A Palestinian-Israeli summit scheduled to take place tomorrow has been delayed. Palestinian Prime Minister Mahmoud Abbas and his Israeli counterpart Ariel Sharon postponed the meeting on the U.S.-backed roadmap to peace. But they dismissed any talk of a new rift ahead of a summit with U.S. President George W. Bush. Officials on both sides cited scheduling problems and not political differences for the postponement. The Palestinians said Sharon and Abbas might meet on Thursday. But Israeli officials said no new date had been set. Sharon was meeting Israeli political leaders and security chiefs to put together a strategy for a three-way summit with the U.S. president. U.S. officials said Bush planned to meet Sharon and Abbas after a trip to Europe next week, and they said Bush may also hold separate talks with other Arab leaders in the Egyptian Red Sea resort of Sharm el-Sheikh. Sharon defended the cabinet's decision to approve the roadmap at an angry meeting with legislators from his own right-wing Likud party. He said he also had reservations about the plan, which paves the way to an independent Palestinian state by 2005. But he said that neither side would gain if Israel occupied the West Bank and Gaza Strip indefinitely. Shimon Peres, slated to be the next leader of the Labor Party, hailed the government's approval of the roadmap as a correct decision. Israeli Foreign Minister Silvan Shalom said that major step now was to get the peace process going again after almost 3 years of violence. He also told the New Zealand's Foreign Minister Phil Goff the planned summit between Israelis and Palestinians gave a glimmer of hope in ending the violence. Arab nations and Israel came together to warn that extremist groups and global terrorists would likely try to derail the new Middle East peace roadmap. A declaration at the end of a meeting of foreign ministers from the European Union and Middle East in Crete put aside political differences for a general condemnation of terrorism. Foreign Minister Meron Masched told the conference Jordan welcomed the acceptance of the roadmap by all parties without any modifications and hoped that it would herald the relaunching of the Middle East peace process on solid ground. Greek Foreign Minister George Papandreou, whose country is the current president of the EU, said Europe will remain engaged in the peace process. Palestinian Foreign Minister Nabil Shaath said that if Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon came to this week's planned talks without steps for implementation and with reservations, then the process could not get in motion. Syrian Foreign Minister Farouk Bashara said that if the roadmap is comprehensive, it should address the Lebanese and Syrian tracks.
If Mr. Sharon comes tomorrow with specific implementation steps, that's really then a good sign. If he comes with his reservations and his fears and his requirements and so on, then we have not started yet.
I feel the Israelis don't have much choice but to accept the reality, and the reality is there. The Palestinians have not surrendered. They are asking for their rights. The roadmap should be accepted by the Israelis, although they tried to avoid acceptance of the roadmap for the last few months. Syria and Lebanon have been addressed now. The two tracks are united, and they will be a part and parcel of the whole solution in the Middle East.
On the ground, the Israeli occupation army carried more raids into Palestinian towns. A Palestinian boy was killed by Israeli soldiers in the Tul Karam refugee camp in the northern West Bank. Israeli tanks stormed the camp, firing at houses as they clashed with stone-throwing Palestinians. Elsewhere in the West Bank, seven Palestinians were injured, including four children, in an explosion in Hebron. It was not known who was behind the explosion. Palestinian police rushed to the scene, and while a Palestinian officer was looking for explosives at the site, another blast went off, seriously wounding him. Earlier, Israeli forces demolished a Palestinian home near Hebron. Israeli troops also stormed the city of Jenin and its refugee camp, as well as three nearby towns. An Israeli soldier was injured in a clash with Palestinian gunmen. Palestinian security sources said an explosion was heard in the city and a nearby refugee camp where Israeli soldiers imposed a curfew.
The 30th Foreign Ministerial Session of the States Memoring the Organization of the Islamic Conference, OIC, is to open on Wednesday in Tehran with President Mohammad Khatami's speech. Situation in Iraq, the Middle East crisis, campaign against international terrorism, plus several other issues related to the world of Islam will top the three-day session's agenda. The Organization of Islamic Conference was established in 1969 and has now turned into one of active international circles. Representatives from 57 OIC member states arrived in Tehran on Tuesday to attend the session.
Iraq, its crisis is a crucial one. And I'm sure the foreign minister will focus on this issue.
We extended for the role of Iran since the last summit. And no doubt we will support the role of Iran in order to lead this conference to the successful result.
Our position is the Iraqi people are the one who rule themselves. And the high official meeting which held before from all the OIC members, they lay out a proposal resolution.
Iranian President Mohammad Khatami met and confirmed the Secretary General of the Organization of the Islamic Conference, Abdul Wahid Belghiziz, in Tehran on Tuesday.
During the meeting, President Khatami said campaign against terrorism is on the shoulder of all Muslim states. Expressing opposition against Washington's unilateralism, Mr. Khatami said Tehran's foreign ministerial OIC session is expected to reach solutions concerning matters related to the region and the world of Islam. Elsewhere in his words, the Iranian president touched upon the continuation of the Israeli Zionist regime's atrocities in the occupied lands, as well as the situation of the oppressed Palestinians, and reiterated lasting peace in the region can be achieved only through the fulfillment of Palestinians' legitimate rights.
Russian Minister of Atomic Energy Alexander Romantsev held in talks with the visiting deputy head of Iran's Atomic Energy Organization on Tuesday, stressed the need for Tehran-Moscow further cooperation in peaceful utilization of nuclear energy. Alexander Romantsev underscored the differences between Iran and U.S. leave no effect on Tehran-Moscow joint efforts to go ahead with the construction of Iran's Bushehr power plant. The Russian official reiterated that Moscow will remain committed to the previously agreements concluded with Tehran, even if the commitments are found in contradiction with the U.S. demands. The Russian official further pointed out that the completion of the first unit of Bushehr's nuclear power plant is scheduled to be reviewed during the visit of the head of Iranian Atomic Energy Organization to Moscow in June.
Mosaic is made possible by a grant from the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, which promotes journalism excellence worldwide and invests in the vitality of 26 U.S. communities. And the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation,